Welcome back, I'm That Chemist, and today I have a great story to share with everyone. This story is about the secret behind a strange stimulant. For quite a while, I've been familiar with this anti-nausea medication called Gravol. It's a common medication that people take when they're going on car trips and they're worried about getting car sick, or if you're sailing, people might take this so that they don't get seasick, and another really common case is on airplanes where you might get plane sick. And one of the two ingredients in Gravol is this strange stimulant. There's two different ingredients in Gravol. The first one is diphenhydramine, and the second one is 8-chlorothiophylline, and that's the strange stimulant that we see in here. If you've seen the structure of caffeine before, this might look a little bit similar, and we'll get into why that is later on. When you have the combination of these two drugs, it's called dimenhydrinate. So what is diphenhydramine? It's the first component of Gravol. Well, I'm sure you're familiar with Benadryl. Benadryl is actually the drug diphenhydramine, and it's an antihistamine. This is something that people commonly take if they have allergies. This is an older antihistamine. There are newer ones available that are more selective. And allergy medicine works primarily by targeting the histamine 1 receptor, which is also known as the H1 receptor. But there are many other histamine receptors in the body that may play a role as well, such as histamine 2. Now, for many drugs, there's a certain target that you're trying to hit in the body. But when you hit that one target, you might also hit a lot of other targets. And when you have a drug, there's usually three different ways it works. It can be an antagonist or an agonist. And occasionally, it can be an inverse agonist. And so, you can think of an antagonist like a wrench. It's when you throw a wrench into a machine and the machine breaks. So this is a way to stop a receptor from doing what it's doing. An agonist is like a key in a lock. When it hits that lock, it does what it's supposed to do. Maybe the key doesn't turn the mechanism all the way. Maybe it only turns it part of the way. And then you come across something called an inverse agonist, which is like sticking a key in the lock and turning it backwards, which you can't necessarily do with a key and lock analogy, but it does the reverse function of the enzyme in this case. So rather than just blocking the enzyme, this is actually an inverse agonist for the histamine 1 receptor. It's also worth noting, as I said earlier, there's drugs that can target many different receptors, that diphenhydramine also tends to be an antagonist for the muscarinic acetylcholine receptors. I'm not going to go into much more detail here, but some of the side effects and active effects of diphenhydramine are coming from this activity. And in terms of different drug classifications, diphenhydramine is considered to be a member of the ethanolamine class of antihistamines. So you might be surprised to know that allergy medicine is actually what's in Gravol. So let's talk about the discovery of diphenhydramine. Initially, it was patented in 1947. This first guy applied for the patent in 1944, and it ended up getting approved in 1947, although it was already available by prescription only in 1946. Prior to the patent being approved. If you're curious about the way that he did this, he made it using diphenylmethylbromide and the corresponding dimethylaminoethanol. A few years later, this other guy also patented the drug, although he used a marginally different route. He initially applied for this patent in 1947, but it was approved in 1951, and he had this very original and creative idea to use diphenylmethanol and the corresponding dimethylaminoethylbromide. Basically the same idea, not that surprising or unique. If you're not a chemist, you don't need to worry about those two things, but for the chemists who are listening, I thought this might be of interest. So as this was one of the first antihistamines, it's considered a first generation antihistamine, it has a lot of off-target activity, which means that it's hitting other receptors aside from the one you want to hit, that's what that's called. This means that it's not that selective, and it can reach other receptors besides the histamine 1 receptor. Additionally, for this drug to be effective, it has to cross the blood-brain barrier. So this might affect other receptors also within the brain, because it has to cross the blood-brain barrier, and it tends to have a wide range of activity. Now, when you have a histamine 1 inverse agonist, like diphenhydramine, it can lead to several different effects. One of those effects is decreased severity of your allergy symptoms. So maybe you won't have as much inflammation, maybe your airways will open up a little more. Benadryl is commonly used if you have a mosquito bite, for instance, and you want the swelling to go down, you can apply that topically and that will usually be effective. Additionally, it has a sedative and drowsiness effect, although with Gen 2 antihistamines, even though they tend to still be selective for the H1 receptor, there tends to be less drowsiness. So this could also have something to do with some of its other wide range of activity. And finally, you might expect decreased nausea and motion sickness, and this might also have something to do with the anti-muscarinic activity of diphenhydramine. Finally, it's worth noting that this anticholinergic activity could cause dry mouth and increase heart rate, which is also known as tachycardia. Now, for me, the main case where I experienced motion sickness growing up was if I was playing on my Game Boy or DS in the car while we were driving somewhere, but more recently I've experienced it when playing VR. VR stands for virtual reality, and when you're doing VR, there's a couple different types of motion sickness you might encounter. In my experience, if you're standing in a stationary game doing something like Beat Saber where you're chopping through the blocks, I don't tend to get that motion sick as long as the lenses are appropriately focused for my eyes. Certain VR headsets will allow you to modify the interpupillary distance between your eyes, which helps you appropriately see everything focused, but other lower-end headsets won't necessarily have that capability.
That is not a very polite thing to be showing everyone.
Another consideration is if you're moving in VR, and if you're moving with a joystick, because your body doesn't feel that inertia, but you see the inertia in 3D, it can definitely cause motion sickness. Now, another consideration is if you're moving around your room in VR, which you can often do, but you're also moving with the joystick, your body really doesn't like that, and I get motion sick pretty quickly doing that. So if you're new to VR, or if you're planning on trying VR, I would recommend playing a stationary game rather than one where you're moving with a joystick, and you gradually have to ease your way into it. If you try and push through the motion sickness, you'll just get sensitized to it and it'll get worse faster. So as soon as you start getting motion sick, you just need to stop and take a break till you stop feeling motion sick. And maybe that means you only can play for like 20 minutes at a time. And if you actively do this every day, you can work up your tolerance a little bit. In this footage, you can see me playing with a Valve Index, and it's currently one of several popular consumer headsets on the market. Now, when you're getting motion sick, there's a couple different reasons why you'll feel motion sick. One of the reasons is that you feel the motion, your body feels the motion, but you don't see that motion. So this would be like you're in a car, you're in a boat, you're on a plane, and you're looking at something, and you can't see the frame of reference that you're in. So your body feels the motion, but you can't see what you're moving with respect to. Another case would be when you see motion, but you don't feel it. So this is more relevant for VR, right? In your headset, you're seeing stuff, stuff's coming at you, you're moving, but your body doesn't feel it because you're moving with a joystick rather than moving your whole body with inertia through the air. Now, another cause of motion sickness is when you're using wireless low-end headsets. So this would be something like Oculus products, for instance, where there's a latency between when you manipulate a controller and when you see that visual effect change. It seems like we're very sensitive to this. And so if this latency is too high, it also triggers this response because you're moving something, you're expecting it, but it's not coming when you expect it to. And that mismatch of input and expectations also causes motion sickness. So this one's easy to solve. Don't use a wireless headset. Use a wired headset, which has a faster rate of data transmission, i.e. you input, it outputs way faster, less likely to have motion sickness. So in essence, motion sickness happens when there's a mismatch between what you feel and what you expect to feel. Oftentimes, this is based on your experience. So the worst case ever for me was when I was playing Blade and Sorcery and I put my headset halfway underwater. So half of my vision was above the water, half of it was below, which if you've ever been to a swimming pool with goggles before, you'll have experienced this before, where you feel the waves and you can like see your whole cone of vision move. And in Blade and Sorcery, this is done really well, although you don't feel any of the inertia. And so it took me about 4 seconds to get like maximum motion sickness doing this. This is the most quickly I've ever got motion sick. 4 seconds of this dumb experiment, and I felt sick for 40 minutes. Would not recommend. Now back to the main focus here, diphenhydramine. Now let's talk about the discovery that diphenhydramine could be used to prevent motion sickness. During the year 1947, Dramamine, which is this combination mixture of diphenhydramine along with 8-chlorothiophylline, was sent by the manufacturer of the allergy clinic of the Johns Hopkins University and Hospital for experimental investigation of its value in the control of symptoms of hay fever and urticaria. This is just synonymous with hives, an allergic reaction of the skin. Now, this being an early experimentation, they did what any logical doctor would do, and they immediately give it to a pregnant woman. The drug was administered to a pregnant woman who complained of getting hives, and who incidentally has suffered all of her life from car sickness. Unexpectedly, the car sickness was relieved as well as the hives. It was possible to control the car sickness of this patient at will. A placebo failed repeatedly, but the drug Dramamine gave her complete relief if she took 50 milligrams of it a few minutes before she boarded the streetcar. So this is the initial discovery of its ability to treat motion sickness. So I just mentioned that 8-chlorothiophylline, that's the reason why we're here. Why is this obscure stimulant here? And so to explain that, let's just talk about xanthines for a moment. Most of you will be familiar with caffeine. This is the most common xanthine that basically all of us consume on a daily basis. Xanthines are a structural class of molecules that target the adenosine receptors as antagonists. So this structure here is the structure of xanthine. Now, if you like your chocolate, you might be familiar with theobromine. Now, ironically, this has to do with the name of the plant that it was discovered from, and the only difference between caffeine and theobromine is it's missing a single methyl group sticking off of this imide nitrogen. Now, these both have similar activity in terms of which receptors they hit. The binding affinity changes a little bit, but they behave similarly in the body. They're adenosine antagonists. Now, another one that's kind of similar is theophylline. It has 2 methyl groups instead of 3 like caffeine, but it doesn't have the methyl group on this imidazole nitrogen. It just has an NH. And so the only difference between theophylline and 8-chlorothiophylline is that we have that chlorine sticking off. And so the primary stimulating effect of xanthines, their stimulants, remember, occurs through antagonism of the adenosine 2A receptor. This is called A2A. While this is the receptor of interest, these also target several other different receptors in the body, and they can cause different effects. This just generally means that they're not specifically selective for the A2A, they'll hit other adenosine receptor subtypes as well. And the way that this causes stimulation is it prevents the inhibition of central neuron excitation. It makes you feel less tired. So if you're not familiar with how caffeine works, as you go about your day-to-day life, your body tends to accumulate more adenosine in the blood. This is a signaling molecule that tells your body, okay, we need to start getting tired, we need to sleep. But maybe you don't want to feel sleepy. So you just take some xanthine, whether that's chocolate, coffee, tea, whatever, and this prevents your body from sending that signal as effectively. The adenosine levels in your blood will still increase more and more, but as long as those receptors are antagonized, you can ignore that signal. Maybe that means you need to take more caffeine, maybe that means you'll have more of the negative side effects of excessive caffeine consumption, but you can prevent that signal for a decent amount of time. And so, among these xanthines, the question is, why 8-chlorothiophylline? This is why we're here. What's the story behind this strange stimulant? In the treatment of various allergies by the antihistaminic drugs, which have appeared so profusely in the last few years, there have been observed undesirable side reactions, such as drowsiness, which detract from their usefulness. Attempts have been made, with certain of the antihistamines, to offset the drowsiness by chemical combination with methylxanthines, selected because of their central nervous system stimulating properties, i.e., diphenhydramine makes you feel sleepy, caffeine wakes you up. So perhaps they could do a combination of the two, one to offset the other. While they both work on completely different parts of the nervous system, there could be the effect that one depresses the nervous system, so you might want to stimulate the nervous system to overcome this. This is the idea of people drinking too much and then taking caffeine to replace it, although that's usually not recommended, and some people will say that that's not effective. But here we have a drug that's doing exactly that, and I think that's a little bit hypocritical. So what they wanted to do is they wanted to form a co-salt of the diphenhydramine with a xanthine, and so they need an acidic xanthine. Diphenhydramine has a basic dimethylamino group, and this could get protonated by a sufficiently strong acid. To form a salt, the xanthine must have an acidic NH, which is able to protonate that unprotonated nitrogen, and so together, they would form a salt. There's another drug with this combination, and it's promethazine. And when you have the combination of promethazine and 8-chlorothiophylline, it's called avamine, which is another anti-nausea, anti-motion sickness drug. Promethazine is another first-generation antihistamine. And when we have this 8-chlorothiophylline, they also call it a theoclate or a teoclate. And I'm going to briefly touch on that later. If you're familiar with organic chemistry at all, usually if something ends in 8, that implies that it's negatively charged. And so this is a hint. And so they have this issue with acidity. The chemical problem has been solved in the case of diphenhydramine by the use of 8-chlorothiophylline, which has a high enough ionization constant to form a stable salt. This just means that it's acidic enough to protonate the diphenhydramine. This is the answer to our question. The salt is readily made by dissolving the 8-chlorothiophylline with a slight excess of the base in a suitable hot organic solvent. On cooling, it precipitates as a nice sandy material in almost quantitative yield. So my initial assumption with this whole thing was that they were using 8-chlorothiophylline to get around intellectual property rights. They were just trying to create a new drug with a slightly different structure so that it could get approved and they could have their share of the market. But it turns out that that's not the case. They were just using this drug because it was still effective as a stimulant, but it was also acidic enough to protonate the diphenhydramine. And so the reasoning for this has to do with acidity. If you've never heard of pKa before, it's a logarithmic scale that talks about relative acidity between different molecules. This is similar to a logarithmic scale like the Richter scale for earthquakes. And because this is a logarithmic scale, an increase of one unit equates to a 10 times decrease in acidity. And so diphenhydramine, that dimethylamino group, when it's protonated to an ammonium salt, it has a pKa of about 9. Most tertiaryamines are about 9 to 10. Theophylline, this one in green shown here, it has this NH which has a pKa of 8.8. Now you can see we couldn't use something like caffeine because there would just be another methyl group there, so it wouldn't have an H that it could donate to the diphenhydramine. Because this pKa is about 8.8, this is really close to the pKa of the conjugate acid of diphenhydramine, and so there's not a great difference in acidity here. That means it won't salt out very well. It won't irreversibly form a salt. However, once we look at 8-chlorothiophylline, this is actually a lot more acidic. It has a pKa of about 5.3. And so you might think, 8.8, 5.3, what's the big difference? Well, it's important to remember that this is a logarithmic scale. So that's a difference of about 10 to the 3.5, which equates to being 3,000 times more acidic. So this is acidic enough that it'll essentially be an irreversible reaction. Once it protonates the diphenhydramine, you should just crash out both together as the salt. And so this is our answer. They need to form dimenhydrinate, which is that combination we talked about on the first slide. When we have this anion, it's called a teoclate. If something ends in 8, that tends to indicate that it's an anion. And so when we mix 8-chlorothiophylline with diphenhydramine, we end up protonating the diphenhydramine, and we end up having 8-chlorothiophylline as our anion, which is also known as a theoclate. And so this is the answer. It doesn't have anything to do with intellectual property. It entirely has to do with chemistry. And so I thought that was a really interesting and satisfying answer that justifies its existence. This was really fun for me to track down, and I'm really glad I finally got to get to the bottom of this because it was something that had been bugging me for a few years. Finally, I'd really like to thank Yu Yu and Tay from the Discord for their help on this project. I hope you've enjoyed this video, and I hope you have a great day.